And welcome to a freshly grounded, the brand new podcast.
Well, it's not exactly brand new anymore, is it?
Welcome to freshly grounded, the podcast.
That's better.
Created by best friends, Faisal and Sam.
Huh?
Welcome to freshly grounded.
After that bit.
Best friends, Faisal and Sam.
Really?
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, brothers and sisters. Welcome to a special live stream of Freshly Grounded. We obviously already released an episode today, but this one was a must, and we decided to live stream it, inshallah. So welcome. We are joined by Ustad Yahya Rabi. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, Ustad.
Alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Ahlan wa sahlan. Hayyakallah.
Alhamdulillah, jazakallah khair for joining us, Ustad. Okay, I'm going to get straight into it.
No problem.
As Muslims, we're meant to love the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam more than we love any human on this planet, right? Like more than our parents, our families, our children. And I think that the sad reality is that a lot of us don't know him sallallahu alaihi wasallam well enough to wholeheartedly say that we do love him as we should, right? So whilst it doesn't actually replace us studying about his life in depth, my aim on this live stream is to perhaps try and instill more love for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam for myself and also for the audience and anyone who is listening. Okay, so my first question to you is, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, did he actually cry for us, and was he actually concerned for us, like me, Faisal, like the Muslims listen to his podcast, the people in this day and age, his ummah, was he worried and caring for us as we are now? That's my question.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومن والاه اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. Talking about the messenger عليه الصلاة والسلام and the characteristics of our beloved messenger عليه الصلاة والسلام and his traits and speaking about him and the beauty of the messenger عليه الصلاة والسلام, it is hadith وذو شجون. It is a topic that perhaps will never end. We can spend all night talking about it. Ali ibn Abi Talib, the cousin of the messenger عليه الصلاة والسلام رضي الله عنه وارضاه, he was asked about how much the Sahaba رضي الله عنهم they loved the messenger عليه الصلاة والسلام. So Ali رضي الله عنه said, كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أحب إلينا من أموالنا وآبائنا وأبنائنا وأنفسنا والماء البارد على الظمأ. Look at this. He says the messenger عليه الصلاة والسلام is more beloved to us than our parents, our children, our wealth, even ourselves, يعني. And even he says, الماء البارد على الظمع, the cold water on your thirst. You know, when you're extremely thirsty, the thing that you desire most is cold water, right? He said, the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام more beloved to us than that. And the Sahaba رضي الله عنهم, when they said statements like this, they actually meant it. It wasn't something that they made it up, or they just said to sound, يعني, you know, special. They meant it. It was, and they demonstrated that in their actions, subhanAllah. And that's what Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala says, قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهِ فَاتَّبِعُونِ يُحْبِبُكُمُ اللَّهُ وَيَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ ذُنُوبَكُمْ وَاللَّهُ غَفُورُ رَحِيمُ. Say to him, O Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam, if you truly love Allah, then follow me, following the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, is how you demonstrate your love for the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam. And the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasalam, he loved this ummah a lot. He yearned to meet us. He sallallahu alayhi wasalam, he would say, he would stand, he would say, وَدِدْتُ, I wish that I could meet my brothers, ikhwani. And the Sahaba, they say, Ya Rasulullah, awalasna ikhwanuk? Are we not your brothers? And he said, Antum ashab, you're my companions. He said, ikhwani, my brothers are those who will come after me and they believe in me and they haven't seen me. Yani us. The Messenger alayhi salam yearned to meet us, subhanAllah, the love that he had, the rahmah, right? Rather, the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, he would cry, he would stand nights, crying for his ummah. One night the Messenger عليه الصلاة والسلام was praying Qiyamul Layl as he normally would do. And then he started reciting ayat at the end of Surah Ma'idah. And then he got to the ayah that Allah Azza wa Jalla says, إِن تُعَذِّبُهُمْ فَإِنَّهُمْ عِبَادُكَ. If you punish them, ya Allah, then they are your slaves. وَإِن تَغْفِرْ لَهُمْ فَإِنَّكَ أَنْتَ الْعَزِيزُ الْحَكِيمُ. إِن تُعَذِّبُهُمْ فَإِنَّهُمْ عِبَادُكَ وَإِن تَغْفِرْ لَهُمْ فَإِنَّكَ أَنْتَ الْعَزِيزُ الْحَكِيمُ. He kept repeating this the whole night and then crying and crying and crying. If you punish them, ya Allah, then they are your slaves. And if you forgive them, then you are the Almighty and the All-Wise. And the Messenger عليه السلام kept crying until Jibreel عليه السلام came down. And he said, ya Muhammad, what is the matter? And the Messenger عليه السلام said, Ummati, 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 my nation, my Ummah, my Ummah, my Ummah, crying for us. And then Jibreel عليه السلام, he said to him, ya Muhammad, Allah تبارك وتعالى is going to please you regarding your Ummah. Look at that. And the Messenger عليه السلام spent the whole night crying because of us. He was afraid for us. And the mercy and the compassion that he had for sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, and if you look at his life, straight from the beginning all the way to the end, the difficulties that he went through, it's extraordinary. The difficulties he went through, these difficulties and the hardships the Messenger alayhi salam went through, it would make someone think, you know, I have my own problems to deal with. Why on earth would I think about others? But the Messenger alayhi salam was extremely selfless and he cared about us. And that's why he's rahmatul alameen. Allah Azza wa Jalla described him as a mercy to mankind and rahmah. As Allah Azza wa Jalla, ma arsalnaka illa rahmatan lil alamin. So that mercy that the Messenger alayhi salam he had for us, and what Allah Azza wa Jalla says about him, لَقَدْ جَاءَكُمْ رَسُولٌ مِّنْ أَنفُسِكُمْ عَزِيزٌ عَلَيْهِ مَا عَنِتُّمْ حَرِيصٌ عَلَيْكُمْ بِالْمُؤْمِنِينَ رَؤُوفٌ رَحِيمٌ. بِالْمُؤْمِنِينَ رَؤُوفٌ رَحِيمٌ. He is merciful and compassionate towards believers. Allah Azza wa Jalla constantly praises him through the Quran. وَرَفَعْنَا لَكَ ذِكْرَكَ. We have raised your status, your repute. And Allah Azza wa Jalla says also in the Quran, وَإِنَّكَ لَعَلَى خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ. Verily, you are of great character, mannerism, O Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam. فَبِمَا رَحْمَةٍ مِّنَ اللَّهِ لِنْتَ لَهُمْ وَلَوْ كُنْتَ فَضًّا غَلِيظَ الْقَلْبِ لَنْفَضُّوا مِنْ حَوْلِكَ. Only with the mercy of Allah were you lenient and merciful towards him, O Muhammad alayhi salam. And if you were harsh and you were hard, your heart was hardened, then فضوا من حولك. All the people, they were dispersed from you. So this is how the Messenger alayhi salam, that's why everyone loved him. From young all the way to the end, they loved him, they adored him, because the Messenger alayhi salam was the most beloved and he is the most beloved to us. Umar radiallahu anhu, the Messenger alayhi salam, he said to the Messenger, ya Rasulullah, I love you more than my family and my wealth and everyone else, except myself. And the Prophet ﷺ said, that's not enough, ya Umar. He said, it's not until you love me more than yourself. And then Umar, he went quiet for a moment and then he said, even myself, I love you more than myself. Then the Prophet ﷺ said, al-ana ya Umar, now it's complete. And our iman will be complete if we love the Messenger ﷺ even more than ourselves. Subhanallah. So may Allah tabarak wa ta'ala make us from those who truly love the Messenger ﷺ. Naam.
So I'm assuming that the way we can increase in love about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is by getting to know him sallallahu alaihi wasallam and understanding more about him and his life. And would I be right?
Mm-hmm.
And so you mentioned that you mentioned his mercy,
mm-hmm,
sallallahu alaihi wasallam. There, what else was the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's character like?
Before even going into that, if we look at the life of the Messenger straight from the beginning, right, you see extraordinary things. The Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, he was born an orphan. His father had passed away whilst he was in the womb of his mother. He was taken away from his mother as a baby by Halima al-Sa'diyya. And she breastfed the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam. She nursed him for 2 years, right, or a bit longer. And then he came back to his mother when he was a bit older, after being away from his mother for that long. And then he stays with his mother. Let's say he comes back to his mother, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, about 4 years old, right? And then his mother, at the age of 6, she takes him to Yathrib, which is known as Medina now. And this is where his father died. And she showed him the grave of his father, where his father was buried. Like, you can see the grave of his father, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but he can't see his father. He doesn't know his father, right? Look at the difficulty the child is going through at this time. And then on the journey back, subhanAllah, his mother passes away. He buries his mother. On the journey back from just visiting his father's grave, 6 years old. And then he's taken in by his grandfather, Abdul Muttalib. Abdul Muttalib, he takes in the messenger, alayhi salatu salam. And then he says to him, I'm going to be like a father to you. I'm going to take care of you. And then 2 years later, Abdul Muttalib passes away. Imagine 2 years with his grandfather who took care of him, the chief of Mecca, dies. Then his uncle Abu Talib takes him in. And then Abu Talib, he wasn't very rich. He was going through difficulty financially, etc. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's cousin, Aqil, starts picking on the messenger alayhi salam, trying to harm him in the house of Abu Talib. Right? And Abu Talib would protect him, and then he had to distribute his children so that he could take care of the messenger alayhi salam. Imagine all that difficulty he went through just as a child. Not that his life hasn't fully started yet. And he went through all these trials. If one of us went through that, right, they would not be able to achieve half or not even a percentage of what the messenger alayhi salam he achieved, because these things would perhaps drag them down. But the messenger alayhi salam always, he was optimistic. And this is something that Allah Azza planted in him, right? He grew older and then he became a prophet. And despite all the difficulties going through, people harming him, people calling his name physically, psychologically, all this harm he was facing, he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he went through it. And he showed us the best example in overcoming difficulties, right? This is how he was, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now, he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he had the best character. He had the best outlook on life. He was the man who dealt with people in the best manner. He gave everyone the right that they deserved. He never ever oppressed anyone. If even it seemed like someone oppressed, and he oppressed someone, he said, ah, get your right back. SubhanAllah, that's how he was, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The compassion, the mercy that he had for everyone, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So your question was that you wanted to know other parts of...
I wanted to know about his character.
His character. Naam. Tayyib, we start with ibadatuhu, his worship. Because worship is where character stands from, right? And he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is the one who says, إِنَّ الرَّجُلَ لَيَبْلُغُ بِهَا حُسْنِ خُلُقِهِ دَرَجَةَ الصَّائِمِ الْقَائِمِ. An individual will attain with his good character, right? His good character, the level of the one who constantly fasts, voluntary fasts, and the level of the one who constantly prays, voluntary prayers. So the more ibadah you do, it should be displayed in your character. The Messenger, alayhi salatu wasalam, how was he with his family? How was he with the people? How was he with those who are considered perhaps insignificant in society? The best example. He, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, with his family, he used to say, خَيْرُكُمْ خَيْرُكُمْ لِأَهْلِهِ وَأَنَا خَيْرُكُمْ لِأَهْلِهِ. I'm the best of you are those who are the best of their families. And I'm the best amongst you to their family. And the Messenger, alayhi sallam, who's his first wife? Khadija. He's married to her for 25 years. He never married anyone else with her, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, she was the most beloved person to him. And he wasn't shy of mentioning that. He used to tell everyone. He used to say, إِنِّي رُزِقْتُ حُبَّهَا. Allah has embedded in me her love. He used to say, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That's how much he loved her. To the extent that even after her death, he would mention her and he would praise her, etc. To the extent he's otherwise would become jealous. Aisha radiallahu anha would become jealous. Ya Rasulullah, what is it that you keep mentioning this toothless old woman, she would say. Hasn't Allah replaced her with something better than her? And she means herself. And the Prophet alayhi sallam would say, no. Mm-hmm. And then she would be startled. And then he would say the reasons why. He said, she believed in me and she supported me and aided me when everyone abandoned me, and Allah tabarak wa ta'ala granted me children. And he just went on praising her, praising her. And Aisha regretted even saying that about her, because it made her even more jealous, radiallahu anha. And he loved Khadija, and the way he lived with Khadija was exemplary, right? He, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, 25 years he lived with Khadija, okay? They never argued, they never fought. Their house was a very peaceful home. No arguing, no shouting, never. Mm-hmm. To the extent that Jibreel alayhi salam, he came to the Prophet alayhi salatu salam. And then he said to him, Ya Muhammad. He said to him, Khadija is going to come to you with a bowl of soup. She's going to bring you a bowl of soup. When she comes to you, okay, give her salam from Allah and from myself. And tell her that Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala has prepared for her in Jannah a palace. لا صخب فيه ولا نصب. There's no noise and shouting in it, and there's no tiredness, fatigue or illness in it. Now look at this. Because of what a great woman Khadija radiallahu anha was, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala gave her salam, and Jibreel alayhi salam gave her salam, and on top of that, he gave her glad tidings of a palace in Jannah. And look what he specified. That's going to be in our home in Jannah. There won't be any noise and there won't be any illness. Why? Because in the house of the Prophet ﷺ in Mecca, when she lived with the Prophet ﷺ, there never ever any noise. There was never shouting. There was never any arguments. So that's her reward in Jannah. That Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala has granted her. Radiallahu anha wa ardaha. Right? The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, whenever he would slaughter, okay, an animal, meat, a portion of that animal he would give it to the friends of Khadija out of love for her. Always give it to them. Right? And the wives would become jealous as well. They say, yes, ya Rasulallah. Why is all this woman? Why is it with you and this woman? They'll say to him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he would, one day he would be in the house of Aisha radiallahu anha. And then someone knocks on the door. And then when they knocked on the door, right, they asked, who is it, obviously? And then they heard the voice. And the Prophet alayhi salallahu alayhi wa sallam recognized the voice and he got excited and he said, Allahumma hala, Allahumma hala. Oh Allah, let it be hala. Who's hala? Hala bint Khuwaylid, the sister of Khadija. So Hala came in, the sister Khadija radiallahu anha, and then they sat to her and the messenger alayhi salatu, they were talking about Khadija for hours and Aisha got jealous again. Look at this love that he had, that he displayed even after her death radiallahu anha. Look at the wafa, how loyal he was to his wife and the love he had for her, the compassion he had for her radiallahu anha wa ardaha. Right? And he was like that with his other wives too. Aisha, he loved Aisha a lot. And the Prophet ﷺ naturally was given more love for Aisha more than other wives, but he was extremely just with all his wives. He never treated them unfairly. He was just with them. He never ever, and he showed them that he loved Aisha more, but naturally he can't control his heart. So one day, the wives of the Prophet ﷺ, they came together. And they all came together except Aisha with Fatima radiallahu anha. And with Fatima, they were complaining to Fatima. They said, ya Fatima, speak to your father regarding Aisha, this extra love he has for her. Speak to him. Tell him to stop what he's doing. And the Prophet ﷺ is not doing anything wrong. They're just jealous naturally. So what happens? Fatima radiallahu anha, she goes to the Prophet ﷺ. And she says, ya Rasulullah, verily your wives, they are complaining about the daughter of Abu Bakr, yani Aisha. They're complaining about her. And they're complaining, etc. and so on. And then the Prophet ﷺ, he said, ya Fatima, is it sufficient for you? Does it please you that you love what I love? She said, yes. And then he said to her, love what I love. Love this. Yani Aisha, love her. And then Fatima, she left. And she went back to the wives of the Prophet. She said, listen, I can't do anything, okay? I've done. And khalas. And then what do they do? They said, khalas. Fatima, not going to help us. We're going to get Zainab. Zainab, radiallahu anha, she was the only other wife of the Prophet, alayhi salam, that was, yeah, they used to compete with Aisha in beauty, in how much the Prophet, alayhi salam, loved Aisha. She used to compete with her. She was actual competition for Aisha. So what happened? Zainab, she came to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. And now what they're doing is actually they're transgressing, because they came to the Prophet alayhi salam in the house of Aisha. It's Aisha's day. And they say, ya Rasulullah, the wives of the Prophet alayhi salam are complaining about Aisha. Okay, be fair. The Prophet alayhi salam. So she goes on and on. He just listens, sallallahu alayhi salam. He doesn't respond. And then Aisha's sitting there. She says, ya Rasulullah, can I respond? Like all these people, they're just talking about me. Can I respond on my behalf and defend myself? And the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he can indicate to her, yes. And then Aisha radiallahu anha, she responds, and she was so eloquent in her speech that she completely shut down Zainab. And then the Prophet alayhi salam, he laughed and he said, innaha bint Abu Bakr. He said, really, she's the daughter of Abu Bakr. Can you blame her? Look at the way she just completely destroyed you, your argument, right? Can you blame me for loving her so much? So this is how the Prophet alayhi salam, he was with his wives. He would go through things that any man would go through with his wives. Aisha radiallahu anha, one day she was at home, the Prophet alayhi salam had guests coming over, okay? And then
just when she locked the door.
No. So guests came over. He invited the Sahaba. Okay. So no doubt, obviously, Aisha, she would cook for the guests, etc., to be hospitable, etc. So what happened? One of the other wives, the Prophet ﷺ, she sent her servant to the Prophet ﷺ to take some food, a dish of food, okay, to the house of Aisha for his guests. Now Aisha, she saw this as undermining her, right? Like it's making it seem like she can't and he serve the guests, etc. So she got angry. So the Prophet ﷺ, he took the bowl, the dish, he gave it to Aisha. Aisha was furious. You know what she did? In the presence of the guest, she smashed it. And the Prophet ﷺ, salatu salam, he didn't respond by saying, what are you doing? Imagine this happened to us,
yeah,
right? And you had guests and your wife did that, right? You would be embarrassed, right? You might get angry,
yeah,
right? The Prophet ﷺ never got angry, right? He actually smiled and acted like nothing happened. And then he said to the Sahaba, غارت أمكم. Your mother became jealous. Right, he didn't make a big fuss about it. That's how he was, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Right, one day, the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he had an argument with Aisha. And then their voices became very loud. And Abu Bakr was walking past. And then he walked in and he saw this argument. So what did they so they decided to make Abu Bakr the judge between them, to reconcile between them, the father of Aisha. So Aisha says to the Prophet, okay, you start, you mentioned your side of the story, but only state that which is the truth. When Abu Bakr heard this, he got angry. He said, has he ever lied? And he was about to beat up Aisha, right? His daughter disciplined her. And then the Prophet grabbed Abu Bakr and he threw him out. And then he said to Aisha, did you see how I protected you from that man? I defended you. And then they laughed about it and they completely forgot about the whole argument, the whole problem, subhanAllah. Right? So this is how he was, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, with his family, with his wives, etc. He, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was extremely kind. There was a sahabi known as Zahir, right? And Zahir, he was not very good looking, and he was from those who were, he wasn't very wealthy, he was very poor from the sahaba, and he wasn't from a tribe that was respected, etc. So he was perhaps what people would think an insignificant person in society, but to the Prophet ﷺ, no one's insignificant. So one day Zahir, he came to visit the Prophet ﷺ. The Prophet ﷺ wasn't there. So he went to the market, and the Prophet ﷺ was told he came looking for him. So the Prophet ﷺ went looking for Zahir. Look at this, he went looking for him. And then when he went looking for him, he saw him in the market. And then what did the Prophet ﷺ do? He hugged him from behind. He started hugging him from behind. And then he said, "Man yashtari hadha al-abd? Who's going to buy this slave? Who's going to buy this slave?" And then Zahir is saying, "Let go of me, let go. I'm not a slave, I'm not a slave." And then he realized the voice of the, it's the voice of the Prophet ﷺ. Then he let him hold him. And then he said, "Ya idan tajidini kasidin ya Rasul, tajidini kasidin ya Rasulullah. You're going to find me that I'm not going to have any value, O Messenger of Allah." The Prophet ﷺ, no, he said, la. That's not the case. You are valuable hal عند Allah. You are valuable in the sight of Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala. Look at the ma'ayir. What the Prophet is teaching us, what matters, it's how you are in front of Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala. Forget what these people think about you. It is what Allah Azza wa Jalla thinks about you. That's what makes you the best of the best. This is how he was, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, with all types of society. And if I was to mention examples, we would never end. How he was with children. When the Prophet would be walking past the children of Medina, he would give them all salam. Like every single one of them, he'll give them salam, he'll shake their hands, etc., showing them their importance. Nowadays, who does that when they see their children, give them salam? He would see the child, he would pray salah, and then he would hear a child crying, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and then he would make the salah shorter in, to have mercy upon the mother of that child, and that child is over crying so much. Rahmah, rahmah lil alam in every aspect. Sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam.
When you, there's obviously like different times. Like in different times of your life, different times of your life probably relate to different ahadith, right? Mm-hmm. And so something happens in your life, and then you think, oh, this like reminds me of this hadith and stuff. And we were having a discussion with the boys outside before you came about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and we were speaking about stuff like the time when he was helping the lady travel with her belongings and stuff, and she was just talking about this man called Muhammad the whole time, and stay away from him. And then, but how he finished the journey, and you know, at the end, she ended up becoming a Muslim, if I'm not mistaken. And there was another story that kind of I thought of when you were just mentioning about Aisha radiallahu anha, and it was when we were speaking about outside, and it was one where I remember listening. There was this sheikh who was speaking about it, and I was there live. I was in like the front row of the audience, and for some reason this story just captivated me, probably because I hadn't heard it, right? And it was this story where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam came home a bit late, and Aisha radiallahu anha had locked the door, right? And the reason it captivated me, the story, is because the sheikh said, imagine you coming home and your wife's locked the door. And he goes, what would we be like? This is my house. I pay the rent here. Right. My kids, you better open the door right now. No. And he said, what did the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam do? And he said, he started saying, Ya Aish, Ya Aish, like his cute name for Aisha radiallahu anha. And he started as, like, I don't know, like poetry or whatever, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And she herself, out of like the love, because of what he was saying, she came and opened the door herself. And the reason it resonated with me is because when the Sheikh was saying, what would you be like if the door was locked on you, I was actually thinking, like, that's me. Like, I would be like, why? Like, do not lock the door on me, kind of thing. I wouldn't be able to at that point think, okay, relax. What kind of hadiths come to your mind?
Worst things happened to the Prophet. That was nothing compared to the Prophet endured a lot worse than that. And that's just a minor thing. Like, for the Prophet, it doesn't mean anything to him, and he wouldn't make a big deal out of it. But the Prophet endured worse than that. Imagine the Prophet would be walking the streets of Medina, and then all of a sudden someone comes behind him and they start strangling him until he becomes red and he can't breathe. Okay, you know who this strangling him? Hey, Bedouin, who's Muslim. Because we had the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام strangling him. Oh, he was a Muslim at the time, استغفر الله. But he strangles the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام and he said, Ya Muhammad, give me, look at how rude way he's addressing him. Ya Muhammad, give me the wealth. It's not the wealth, your wealth or your father's wealth. And he debated Mal Muslimin. And he strangled the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام there and he said, leave him. The Prophet looks back at him whilst he's strangling him and he smiles at him. Look at that. And then he says to the Sahaba, give him what he's asked for. And this man, subhanAllah, his heart was softened because of that. SubhanAllah. Yani, even worse than that, right, his enemies, what did they do to him? In Mecca, the Prophet ﷺ would be praying by the Kaaba. And then when he'd be praying by the Kaaba, Abu Jahl, okay, he would say to the Prophet ﷺ, if I see you praying there, I'm going to harm you. Right? And he would threaten the Prophet ﷺ. And one day the Prophet ﷺ was praying, Abu Jahl tried to come and attack the Prophet ﷺ. What happened? As he came closer and he wanted to attack the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, Abu Jahl all of a sudden stopped and he got startled and he got scared, terrified, frightened. And then after the Prophet alayhi salam finished his salah, the Prophet alayhi salam said, wallahi, if he took another step forward, he would have been finished. And the angels were there, they would have completely destroyed him. Right? And he saw that. He got terrified. They would have completely destroyed him. So Allah tabarak wa ta'ala is protecting the Prophet alayhi salam. But there was times where some of them did actually harm the Prophet alayhi salam. There was a man who was known as Uqba ibn Abi Mu'ayt. Uqba, one day the Prophet ﷺ was praying by the Kaaba, and when he went to sujood, he threw the insides of a camel on top of the Prophet ﷺ. And then Fatima, and she was a little child, she came and she removed the Prophet ﷺ, right?
Imagine that scene, just imagine that scene.
Her father, imagine, right? And then it's another instance where Uqba, the same man, he came and the Prophet ﷺ was in Salah, and then he came behind him and he started strangling the Prophet ﷺ, tried to kill him, right? And then Abu Bakr came and pushed him off and he said, أَتَقْتُلُونَ رَجُلًا أَنْ يَقُولَ رَبِّيَ اللَّهِ. Are you trying to kill a man because he said, my Lord is Allah, the one and only who should be worshipped, right? So that was the attempt. But then the Prophet ﷺ, right, it was very rare the Prophet ﷺ, he made dua against anyone. But there was individuals the Prophet ﷺ made dua against. Okay, their end wasn't good. And he named them by name after that incident. Amongst them was Abu Jahl, okay, Uqba ibn Mu'ayt, Umayy ibn Khalaf, and all these guys, he named them by name, the Prophet ﷺ, out of distress and so on. And all of them, they were killed in the Battle of Badr, right? That's how they ended up, right? So Allah tabarak wa ta'ala always protects his messenger alayhi salam. No matter whoever tries to harm him, those who try to harm him with their tongue, those who try to physically harm him, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala always defend the messenger. Allah says in the Quran, inna alladhina yu'dhuna Allah wa rasulahu la'anahum Allah fi dunya wal akhirah wa'adda lahum 'adhabum. Those who try to harm Allah and his messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah azza wa jalla curses them in the dunya and akhirah, he's prepared for them a humiliating punishment. And also Allah says, walladhina yu'dhuna رسول الله لهم عذاب أليم. Those who harm the Messenger عليه الصلاة والسلام, they have a painful punishment. So this is the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. There's an incident. Look at this Taif, the day of Taif. Look at this. The Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, he went, left Mecca. After people in Mecca, they gave him such a hard time. They disbelieved. They were refusing his message. And then he went to Taif to call the people of Taif to Islam, hoping that they would embrace Islam. So he went there, and then what did the people of Taif do? They sent their foolish and their children and those who were insane amongst them, their women, to stone the Prophet Ali, pelt him with stones until his sandals were filled with blood. And then he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, left Taif. And then he sat under a tree and then he made his famous dua, crying to Allah tabarak wa ta'ala. He said, oh Allah, I ask you, okay, he said, Allahumma ashku ilayka da'fa quwwati. Oh Allah, I complain to you the weakness of my strength, my weakness. وَقِلَّةَ حِيلَتِي, and the lack of ability that I have to do anything. وَهَوَانِي عَلَى النَّاسِ, and that the people, they are degrading me and they are trying to belittle me, etc. I complain all that to you, Ya Allah. He complained all that to Allah. And he said, إِلَى مَنْ تَكِلُونِي, who are you going to make me, who are you going to make me make responsible for my affairs? إِلَى عَدُوٍ يَتَجَهَّمُنِي, is it to an enemy who's trying to attack me and harm me? Or ila ba'idin, or to someone who's distant from me, who does not care for me? He says at the end, a'udhu bi nuri wajhika, I seek refuge with the light of your face, that you are angry with me, Ya Allah. Look at the Prophet ﷺ blaming himself after this. He thinks he's done something wrong. Look at this, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he never blamed the people. those who even harmed them, he never said it's their fault. He said, I'm afraid, Ya Allah, that I have done something wrong and you're angry with me, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he said, A'udhu bi nuri wajhika. He said, I seek refuge, okay, with the light of your face, and yakuna, that your anger is upon me. And then he said, لَكَ الْعُتْبَى حَتَّى تَرْضَى لَكَ الْعُتْبَى حَتَّى تَرْضَى لَكَ الْعُتْبَى حَتَّى تَرْضَى. And for you, Ya Allah, I supplicate and I seek refuge and I seek forgiveness for my sins and my mistakes until you're pleased, Ya Allah, until you're pleased and that you're no longer angry with me. SubhanAllah. Look at the way the Messenger, alayhi salam, he's thinking. And then Allah Tabarak wa ta'ala sends the angels in the famous incident. And he sends the angel of the mountain. He said, Ya Muhammad, Ya Rasulullah, if you command me right now to destroy these people and put these mountains together and completely destroy them, I'll do so. Just command me. And the Prophet, alayhi salam, said, no. Rather, I hope and I ask Allah Tabarak wa ta'ala that he brings from their backbones those who worship him, don't associate any partners with him. Look at the Prophet alayhi wasallam, the optimism he has and how hopeful he is and how merciful he is to others. Even those who harm him, he didn't say destroy them all, right? Rather, he sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he was optimistic and he had good assumptions of Allah and he always hoped good for them and he wished good for them. And that's exactly what happened. The Prophet alayhi wasallam, he was thinking about the legacy that he was going to leave behind. And because of that, That yani motivation that he had and that goal he's working to, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to serve the religion of Allah and to serve Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, this legacy has reached us and we are talking about the Messenger alayhi wa sallam right now, sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam.
One thing that I found really amazing this morning was when I was looking at different khatibs, like Ustad Abdul Ahad, as I mentioned to you, Ustad Tim Humble, yourself, all of these different people doing the Jum'ah Salah and their khutbah, everyone's khutbah was about the same thing. And I thought it was all about the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And I thought, I was just reflecting, look at how amazing this is, that almost every khutbah that I've seen today or that I've heard of today is all on the same thing. And it's not like everybody came together and was like, oh, what are you doing your khutbah? And what are you doing your khutbah? And like, everyone's just done like, everyone's talking about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the love of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and people are talking about him sallallahu alaihi wasallam so highly. And it's just like all at the same time, and it's just amazing to see, like, regardless of what people had planned for their khutbahs today, they would have changed it. And if you was like on YouTube at 12:30 today, and you just like look at all the khutbahs that are being live streamed, like just the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it was amazing to see.
It shows the love that the ummah they really have for the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, and that they don't allow anything to tarnish the honor of the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam. And they yani teach the people about the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, and they show him his great character, and they teach people his seerah and his biography, etc. And that's what we should be doing. This is, you know, Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, sometimes things that are evil, they occur, and we know that they're evil, but sometimes it is goodness. Allah says about hadithas with ifk, when Aisha radiallahu anha, she was accused of something she didn't do. Allah says, لَا تَحْسَبُهُ شَرًّا لَكُمْ بَلْ هُوَ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ. Don't think it's bad for you, rather it's khair for you. Right? Goodness will come out of it. So this, we say, لَا تَحْسَبُهُ شَرًّا لَكُمْ بَلْ هُوَ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ. Don't think it's evil, it's bad for you. Rather it's good for you. Why? Because it's given us an opportunity to teach people about Islam more. It's given us an opportunity to teach people about the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam more. It's given us an opportunity for us to learn about the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam more. Because of that emotion that we're feeling, it pushes us and motivates us to learn about the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam more. What else can we get? يعني, alhamdulillah, it's ni'mah from Allah. يعني, that's what Ibn Qayyim rahimahullah azza wa jalla, he says something beautiful. He says every calamity that occurs, right, that draws you closer to Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, in reality it is a blessing. And every blessing that distances you from Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, in reality it is a calamity you've been afflicted with. So now this calamity has occurred, we condemn it and we don't support it. However, it is an opportunity for us to teach the people about the Messenger alayhi salam, for us to learn about the Messenger alayhi salam, for us to imitate the Messenger alayhi salam more and learn about him and show our love really by imitating him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So it's some khair is in it, no doubt. And that's why the believer, he always sees, tries to find the khair in everything that occurs. Even the evil things that occur, right, he tries to find the positive aspect, the positive side. And that's how the believer should be. He always tries to look at things from a positive light as well, and not only see the negative side, even though there is a negative side as well, no doubt.
What would you say to a person who is like, you know, I understand that we need to believe in and or we need to follow the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We need to believe in Allah and follow the sunnah but they perhaps don't have that connection where their heart feels connected to, like, When people speak about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they're hot, they get happy. Or when someone speaks bad of him sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they get really sad. When where they don't have that, they don't have that connection. But they say, you know, I'm a Muslim, I believe in Allah, I believe that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the final messenger. But I don't get that. I don't have that thing where I'm like, you see the shuyukh, so many shuyukh have brought out videos in recent days about talking about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and you can see as they speak so passionately, you see at the end of the videos they're crying because they're talking about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But what would you say if a person feels like they don't have that connection? Is that is there an issue there that needs to be fixed?
You know, this could be possible, and it could happen. And the reason why it happens mainly is because the person perhaps does know the Messenger alayhi wasallam a lot. He doesn't know much about him. You know, the more you know someone, right, the more you love them, especially the Messenger alayhi wasallam, wallahi wa billahi wa tallahi, the more you read about the Messenger alayhi wasallam, the more you find out about him, you can't help but to love him, right? Hasan ibn Thabit, who was Sha'ir al-Islam, the poet of Islam, the poet of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Hasan, before he was Muslim, he saw the Prophet alayhi wasalam for the first time. Right? He laid his eyes upon the Prophet alayhi wasalam. You know who he said about the Prophet alayhi wasalam? This is before he even embraced Islam. He said, his famous lines of poetry, quite short. Most people have heard it. He says, وَأَجْمَلُ مِنْكَ لَمْ تَرَ قَطُّ عَيْنِي وَأَحْسَنُ مِنْكَ لَمْ تَلِدِ النِّسَاءُ خُلِقْتَ مُبَرَّأً مِنْ كُلِّ عَيْبٍ كَأَنَّكَ قَدْ خُلِقْتَ كَمَا تَشَاءُ. Subhanallah, look at this. He says, he looks at the Prophet and he says, he says in poetry, and it's very eloquent. He says, my eyes have never seen anyone more beautiful than you, more handsome than you, he says. This is the first time you've ever seen the Prophet alayhi salam. And then he says, وَأَحْسَنُ مِنْكَ, and no one better than you have women ever given birth to, he says. خُلِقْتَ مُبَرَّأَ مِنْ كُلِّ عَيْبٍ. You have been created, look at this. You have been created free from all faults. You know, every single one of us has something that they see as a fault in the way they were created. Like he says, you are free from all faults. As كَأَنَّكَ قَدْ خُلِقْتَ كَمَا تَشَاءُ. As if you were created the way you wished, and you chose the way you wanted to look. Subhanallah, how perfect it is. That's what we see Hasan ibn Thabit. Hasan ibn Thabit, radiallahu anhu, he embraced Islam after that. And he used to defend the Prophet ﷺ with poetry from what Quraysh and someone used to say. And then they used to say, because he's very eloquent, and you know, they used to say to him, how beautiful is your poetry regarding the Messenger alayhi sallam. You know what he used to say? He said, wallahi, you know, my poems, they're not beautiful. You know what makes them beautiful? Just because I mentioned the Prophet alayhi sallam increases in beauty.
I'd love to hear more of his poems.
Right? He would say that the Prophet alayhi sallam be mentioned, and that's what makes it beautiful. If the Prophet alayhi sallam wasn't mentioned, it wouldn't be beautiful. Look at that. And that's how the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, they viewed the Prophet. They loved him and so much. And some of them, like Amr ibn al-As, look at this now. Because the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, the way he treated people and the way he was with everyone, behaved to everyone, he would treat everyone as if they were the most beloved people to him. Beloved person to him, right? So Amr ibn al-As, he embraced Islam quite late, right, after Hijrah. And then Amr ibn al-As, he saw the way the Prophet was treating him. And Amr ibn al-As, he used to, because of the awe and the haybah the Prophet ﷺ, he had, he would say that when I would be sitting with the Prophet ﷺ in his presence, I wouldn't be able to look up at him. Right? I wouldn't be able to look up at him. He would say that if I sat with him, I would look up and I had to look down. And if you asked me to describe the Prophet ﷺ, I wouldn't be able to do so. Subhanallah. And then because the way the Prophet ﷺ interacted with him, he thought he was the most beloved person to the Prophet ﷺ. So what did he do? He went to him and asked him, he said, Ya Rasulullah, who is the most beloved person to you? The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam is Aisha. I said, no, ya Rasulullah. From the men, not the females. He said, Abu Bakr. He said, who's next? Umar. Who's next? Uthman. Who's next? Ali. And the list kept going on. He said, has to be okay, Rasul, enough. He was afraid he was going to be last. But just the fact he asked that, it shows how great the character of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam was, that he made him feel like he's the most beloved person to him. A sahabi known as Jarir ibn Abdullah al-Bajali, radiallahu anhu arda, he embraced Islam quite late. Right, towards the last 3 years of the life of the Prophet ﷺ, last 2 years, not very long, He only spent with the Prophet ﷺ maybe a year, 2 years, right? So he says, مَا رَآنِي رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ إِلَّا تَبَسَّمَ فِي وَجْهِ. He said, the Messenger عليه الصلاة never saw me except that he smiled in my face. وَمَا حَجَبَنِي قَطَّ. And he never ever prevented me from sitting in his gatherings, right? And sometimes, you know, you might have a private gathering, etc. You might say to someone, you know, this is a bit private, exclusive, etc. Like, the Prophet always never let him, told him, go away. And he always smiled at him. So he felt like this. I had this special connection with the Prophet. Only 1 year. Imagine those who spent 20 years, 23 years with the Prophet alayhi salam, from the beginning, how what the experience of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Anas ibn Malik, khadim Rasulillah sallallahu alayhi wasalam, who served the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. What does he say? Look, this shows, look, normally someone who serves you, that there'll be times you tell them to do something, and there'll be times you might ask them, like, why do you do this? Right? Or you might tell them off for doing something wrong. Right? You served the Prophet alayhi wasalam for years. Since he came to Prophet and came to Medina, his mother Umm Sulaym, she took Anas to the Prophet ﷺ. She said, "Ya Rasul, take him as a servant. Let him serve you, so he can learn from the Prophet ﷺ." Right? She was a very smart, intelligent mother, so she the Prophet ﷺ can raise her son, give him tarbiyah. So he says, "Ma qala lil Nabi ﷺ." Okay, the Prophet ﷺ, he never said to me, "Why did you not do something? And why did you do this?" He never ever said to me. And never ever had a go at me. He never ever told me off. Years. Imagine, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he shows a great character, right? Subhanallah. Yani every aspect, in every aspect of his life, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it will show you that. But on top of that, what makes you love the Prophet alayhi wa sallam even more, it is the sacrifices that he made for us. The sacrifices that he made for us and the difficulty he endured, right? Subhanallah. Yani he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his helmet, when the battle of Uhud, it was broken to the extent the metal was stuck inside the sides of his head. His teeth were broken. He was hurt. He was injured in the battle of Uhud, right? And that was the most he was injured in any battle, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, right? And despite that, the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, he went through all of that so that kalimatullah can be the highest. The statement of Allah, la ilaha illallah, can be highest, and that he can convey this message, can reach us in the most difficult time. In one of the most difficult times, Ahzab, you know, the Arabs, all the confederates of the Arabs, the different tribes, they came together, they made an alliance. They made an alliance that they're going to completely destroy the Prophet alayhi salam, the Sahaba, and annihilate them, destroy them, that there won't be any trace left of them. That was their plan. They made this allegiance with Quraysh. So what happened? The Prophet alayhi salam, he knows about this. So they dug a trench around Medina so they couldn't enter. And Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he describes this incident in the Quran. Allah says, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اذْكُرُوا نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ عَلَيْكُمْ إِذْ جَاءَتْكُمْ جُنُودٌ فَأَرْسَلْنَا عَلَيْهِمْ رِيحًا وَجُنُودًا لَمْ تَرَوْهَا وَكَانَ اللَّهُ بِمَا تَعْمَلُونَ بَصِيرًا إِذْ جَاءُوكُمْ مِنْ فَوْقِكُمْ وَمِنْ أَسْفَلَ مِنْكُمْ وَإِذْ زَاغَتِ الْأَبْصَارُ وَبَلَغَتِ الْقُلُوبُ الْحَنَاجِرَ وَتَظُنُّونَ بِاللَّهِ الظُّنُونَا هُنَالِكَ ابْتُلِيَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ وَزُلْزِلُوا زِلْزَالًا شَدِيدًا. Allah says, O you who believe, remember the favors of Allah Azza wa Jalla upon you. إِذْ جَاءَتْكُمْ جُنُودٌ, when troops came upon you. Okay, فَأَرْسَلْنَا عَلَيْهِمْ رِيحًا, we sent wind upon them. وَجُنُودًا لَمْ تَرَوْهَا, and troops that you couldn't see, and Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala is all knowing what you do. Then Allah says, "Ija'ukum min fawqikum," when they came from above you and below you. And then look, Allah describes the Sahaba, how the Sahaba were. Wa idzaghati al-absar. Allah says that the eyes of the Sahaba, it shifted because of fear. Wa balaghati al-qulub al-hanajir. And Allah says that their hearts, it reached their throat, subhanallah, out of fear. Wa tadhunnuna billahi dhununa. And they assumed all sorts of Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala. They assumed all sorts of things about Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala. Allah says, هُنَالِكَ تُولِيَ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ. There the believers were tested and they were shaken and severe shaking. Right? So now look what Allah is saying about the Sahaba, that they were afraid. The Sahaba, what we know about them is that they weren't afraid of dying. Rather, they were the most courageous people. So why were they afraid? Why were they fearful? The Sahaba, they were afraid, if we all die, who is going to carry on the message of Islam? Who's going to convey it? That's why they were afraid. That's only it. They weren't afraid of dying. Right? So at the end of this ayat, after Allah describes what happened in Ahzab and so on, you know Allah says, لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ لِمَنْ كَانَ يَرْجُ اللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمَ الْآخِرَ وَذَكَرَ اللَّهَ كَثِيرًا. Allah says, certainly, in the Messenger Muhammad عليه الصلاة والسلام, is the best example. For who? for those who seek Allah on the last day and remember Allah Azza wa Jalla. Now, what's this got to do with Ahzab? Right? Allah is telling us about the battle of Ahzab and what's happening, difficulties Sahaba going through. Then Allah says, follow the example of the Prophet alayhi salatu, that's the best example. What's the relation? Right? What was the Prophet alayhi salatu doing the Ahzab? When the Sahaba were digging the trenches around Medina, right? Some of the Sahaba, there was a big rock, right? That they couldn't move. So what did they do? They asked the strongest man amongst them to help them. Who was that? The Prophet alayhi salatu. They asked, Ya Rasul, help us, we're stuck. So the Prophet says, no problem. He said, move to a side. And then he came. And then he got his spade, right? And his shovel. And then what did he do? He struck the rock once. And then a third of it became dust. Look at the strength. Allahu Akbar. And then he says, Allahu Akbar, u'titu mafatiha Faris. He said, I have been given the keys to Persia. And we're going to conquer Persia, inshallah. They're going to become Muslim. And then he struck it a second time. Another third of it became dust. And he said, Allahu Akbar, u'titu mafatiha Rome. We're going to conquer Rome. Yani they're going to become Muslims, inshallah ta'ala. Islam is going to reach there. And then he said, Allah, he struck it a third time and it all became dust. And he said, Allahu Akbar, u'titu mafatiha al-Yaman. I have been granted the keys to Yemen. Yani they're going to become Muslims. Islam is going to reach there. Now the hypocrites are looking at the Prophet alayhi salatu salam and they're saying, is he delusional? And he's stuck in this situation. He's talking about Rome, Persia, Yemen. Is he crazy? Allah describes this. وَإِذْ يَقُولُ الْمُنَافِقُونَ وَالَّذِينَ فِي قُلُوبِهِمْ مَرَضٌ مَا وَعَدَنَا اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ إِلَّا غُرُورًا. Allah says, and when the hypocrites said, and those who had illnesses in their heart, that the Prophet and Allah, they don't promise us except delusion. Right? The hypocrites are delusional ones, right? يعني the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, in his difficult time, he was being optimistic. Optimism, and he was embedding that in the Sahaba. The most difficult times, we need to be optimistic. So the same applies to us now, that in the most difficult times we need to be optimistic, because we are certain that khair is going to happen. Khair is coming with every, Allah Azza wa Jalla, with every difficulty there is, not after it, with it. Okay, there are two eases, not one. With every one difficulty, there are two eases. Ma'a, with it. Allah doesn't say ba'da in the Quran, not after. Allah says, فَإِنَّ مَعَ الْعُسْرِ يُسْرَى إِنَّ مَعَ الْعُسْرِ يُسْرَى. Verily with each difficulty, there is an ease. And then Allah says, with each difficulty, there is ease. يعني, العسر, it's definite, meaning one hardship. Yusr is indefinite, meaning two. Meaning with each hardship, there are two eases that go with it. So that's why we're optimistic. We have good assumptions of Allah. And that's what the Prophet ﷺ, he taught the Sahaba. And that's what we learned from it as well. That in these difficult times, we're also optimistic. And Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala never lets down this religion. And Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala will owe this religion. And I'll give you one example. One example, and I've speaking for too long, subhanAllah. I must be boring you. But I'll give you an example, inshallah ta'ala. The Prophet alayhi sallam, when he became a prophet, he sent letters to the leaders of the world in Persia, Kisra, and he sent to Rome, yani Caesar of Rome, etc. He sent to different rulers. So when the messenger of the Prophet alayhi sallam went to Persia and he gave the letter of the Prophet alayhi sallam, he read it to Kisra, the ruler of Persia, the king of Persia. The king of Persia, he heard it and he said, give it to me. And then he looked at it. And then what did he do? He ripped it apart. He disrespected the letter of the Prophet alayhi salam. And then the Prophet alayhi salam, his messenger also went to Caesar of Rome, right? And he read the letter to him. And then he looked at it, he respected it, he put it somewhere respectfully, etc. Right? Now when the Prophet alayhi salam, he heard about these two different responses, okay, when the Prophet alayhi salam, he heard about how Kisra, the king of Persia, how he responded, the Prophet alayhi salam, mazzaqallahu mulka, he said, may Allah rip his kingdom, just like he disrespected. So what happened? You know, only a few, like a short period of time after that incident, you know what happened to Kisra? His own son assassinated him, subhanAllah. A coup, he took over, assassinated him. And then he took over. And the Persian Empire, it didn't last as long as the Roman Empire. Because the Roman Empire, the Romans, they respected the Prophet's letter. It lasted a bit longer. Whereas the Persian Empire didn't last as long. They completely collapsed. SubhanAllah, right? So that's sunnatullahi fi ardi. That's the sunnah of Allah on earth, right? So may Allah Azza wa Jalla grant us goodness, inshallah.
I mean, jazakallah khair, Ustad. Brothers and sisters, those who are watching this stream live, if you would want to comment in the comment section in the live chat with questions or talking points for Ustad Yahya Hafidhullah, you're more than welcome to do so. And if we get a chance, we probably won't obviously get a chance to talk about most of them, but if we do, we are gonna have someone keeping an eye on them, inshallah.
Ustad, I would love to hear, I'm putting you on the spot here now, but I'd love to hear some more poems, because I've heard you recite poems before, and I just love hearing poems, especially when we hear the meaning of them after. Is that all right?
No problem. I'll give you one poem, which is quite short, but okay. Very eloquent. Fine. And it connects to our topic. Al-Qadhi Iyadh, rahimahullah azza wa jal. Actually, Al-Qadhi Iyadh, right, he has a book called Ash-Shifa. Right, and Ash-Shifa, it talks about the characteristics and the traits of the Prophet and his personality, his baggage, everything. It's a very big book. When did he write it? He wrote it when an individual that lived in his time installed to the Prophet. He wrote this book in order to teach the people about the seal of the Prophet, Ash-Shifa, which is a very good book. Al-Qadhi Iyadh, this lines of poetry that are attributed to him, right? He says, وَمِمَّا زَادَنِي شَرَفًا وَتِيهَا وكدت بأخمصي أطأ الثريا دخولي تحت قولك يا عبادي وأن صيرت أحمد لي نبيا صلى الله عليه وسلم. He says, look at this. And this is يعني a message for all of us. ومما زادني شرفا وتيها. What increased me in honor and made me someone who's very honorable, and made me someone, he says. وَكِدْتُ بِأَخْمُصِي أَطَّأُ الثُّرِيَّ. And because of the honor, and that this, يعني, that I've been granted, that I almost reached the stars, he says. I almost reached the stars because of this honor. And I went so high up, he says, because of the honor I've been granted, he says, دُخُولِي تَحْتَ قُولِكَ يَا عِبَادِي. He says, just the fact that I am included in the statement of Allah Azza wa Jalla, Ya Ibadi, O my slaves. That Allah calls me and says, O my slaves. That is honorable for me. That is honor. And then he ends by saying, وَأَنْ صَيَّرْتَ أَحْمَدَ لِي نَبِيًّا. And that you have made Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, my messenger, my prophet. That's honorable for us. Just the fact away from his ummah, right? Mm-hmm. That's the greatest honor, one of the greatest honors that we have. And we should feel that, and we should be proud of that, and we should show it off everywhere. My Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Prophet did not tell us to go overboard in him, and to go to extremes in him. But we should be proud of our Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and we show our love and we display it to him in a way that is obviously permitted, and we don't do things that are impermissible, etc. And the Prophet alayhi salam, okay, from his legacy, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he left behind a great legacy. And if we would talk about the legacy of the Prophet alayhi wa sallam, we were talking about it already, we will never ever stop. Huge legacy, okay? He, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, okay, they say that if you want to know how great a teacher is, okay, they say, look at his students, those who graduate from his school. Look at them, what sort of people they turn out to be. The Prophet alayhi salatu wa sallam, he produced the best students, Sahabatu Rasulillah, the companions of the Messenger alayhi salatu wa sallam, the best students, his companions, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now the companions, as we mentioned on the last podcast, do you remember? We mentioned amongst them are those who were promised paradise, right? Right, and amongst them were those who were extremely virtuous. Amongst them were those who, they did all sorts of great stuff. But look at the tarbiyah, the way the Prophet ﷺ nurtured them. The way the Prophet ﷺ nurtured them. Right, in the last podcast, I mentioned the story of Umar radiallahu anhu, and how he was promised paradise, but he still was afraid. Right, he had that fear. He thought he would think that I'm not going to go to Jannah, etc. Uthman radiallahu anhu was similar to that. Ali radiallahu anhu, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, similar to that. That fear that they had. But I'll give you another example. Aisha radiallahu anha, Umm al-Mu'mineen radiallahu anha, she would recite the statement of Allah Azza wa Jalla. Allah says, ثُمَّ أَوْرَثْنَا الْكِتَابَ الَّذِينَ اصْطَفَيْنَا مِنْ عِبَادِنَا فَمِنْهُمْ ظَالِمٌ لِنَفْسِهِ وَمِنْهُمْ مُقْتَصِدٌ وَمِنْهُمْ سَابِقٌ بِالْخَيْرَاتِ بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ ذَلِكَ هُوَ الْفَضْلُ الْكَبِيرُ. She recited the statement of Allah that Allah says that we have allowed to inherit the scripture, i.e. the Quran, those that we have chosen from ourselves, the Muslims, Allah chooses the people amongst them. Then Allah says that there are three categories amongst them. Amongst them are those who are oppressed to themselves, i.e. those who, they do the obligatory deeds, but they have shortcomings and they do sins, etc. And the second category, those who are in the middle, yani they do the obligatory deeds and they stay away from the haram. And then there's the third category, those who hasten towards the goodness and they rush towards it. And those are the ones who do the obligatory deeds and they stay away from haram, and they do the voluntary deeds on top. يعني الشيخ علي الطنطاوي رحمه الله عز وجل, when he explains it, he said, يعني it's جيد, جيد جدا and ممتاز. And he says, good, very good and excellent. يعني عائشة أم المؤمنين رضي الله عنها, the wife of the Messenger عليه الصلاة والسلام, she would say, أَنَا ظَالِمَةٌ لِنَفْسِهَا. Subhanallah, I am one who is oppressive to herself. Would she say that out of humility? Did she say it just to sound humble? لا, they actually believed this. And that's why the Sahaba رضي الله عنهم, because of the humility they had, they were able to achieve so much and they carried on legacy because they always thought that whatever I did, it wasn't enough for Jannah. It's not enough. My deeds are not enough. I need to do more and more. And that's why this great legacy that reached us, it's reached us through their efforts that they carried on after the death of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. Her sister Asma رضي الله عنها وأرضاها, one day she was praying قيام الليل. And then her servant, he saw her praying. She started reciting Surah Al-Tur, and she got to the ayah that Allah Azza wa Jalla says, فَمَنَّ اللَّهُ عَلَيْنَا وَوَقَانَا عَذَابَ السَّمُومِ فَمَنَّ اللَّهُ عَلَيْنَا وَوَقَانَا عَذَابَ السَّمُومِ. She kept repeating this ayah that Allah says about the people of Jannah, that the people of Jannah, when they enter Jannah, they will say, Allah Azza wa Jal has bestowed His favors upon us by allowing us to enter Jannah. وَوَقَانَا عَذَابَ السَّمُومِ. And He protected us from the hellfire, right? And she kept repeating this ayah, and she was crying, and she was asking Allah for Jannah, and seeking refuge in Allah Azza from the hellfire. Kept crying. She was implementing the following verse that Allah says, إِنَّا كُنَّا مِن قَبْلُ نَدْعُوهُ إِنَّهُ هُوَ الْبَرُّ الرَّحِيمُ. Verily, the people of Jannah, they say, we used to call upon Allah in the dunya. We used to call upon Him and ask Him for Jannah and seek refuge in Him from the hellfire. And verily Allah is the beneficent, the most merciful. Her servant, he left her while she was repeating that ayah. He came back just before Fajr and he found her still in that state, subhanAllah. Look at the fear they had. And that's why they did all these great stuff. And it's as if their actions were saying that what the poet, he said. The poet, he said, إِلَهِ لَسْتُ لِلْفِرْدَوْسِ أَهْلًا ولا أقوى على نار الجحيم فهب لي توبة واغفر ذنوبي فإنك غافر الذنب العظيم. He said, إلهي, Allah, لست للفردوس أهلا. I'm not one who deserves الفردوس. يعني my deeds are not enough to get me to فردوس, جنة. And then he says, وَلَا أَقْوَى عَلَى نَارِ الْجَحِيمِ. And I don't have the strength to cope in the hellfire either. And I don't have, my deeds are not enough to get me to Firdaus. But I don't have the strength to cope in the hellfire. And then he said, فَهَبْ لِي تَوْبَةً وَغْفِرْ ذُنُوبِي. He said, so Ya Allah, grant me repentance. And give me repentance. And forgive my sins. فَإِنَّكَ غَافِرُ الذَّنْبَ الْعَظِيمِ. For verily you are the one who forgives even the major, the worst sins. Right? It is as if the actions of the Sahaba رضي الله عنهم, they were saying this. This is what the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام taught them. He embedded this in them, right? And they learned this, they took this from the actions of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, the statements of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. It is his legacy that has come all the way down to us, right? So we need to be the ones, in order to leave a legacy, we need to live the legacy. We need to live the legacy of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, live the legacy of the Sahaba رضي الله عنهم. And if you do that, 100%, you're going to leave a legacy as well that to carry on even after your death, inshallah, تبارك وتعالى. نعم.
I was, when I was looking at these points that we had, from last night from one of those the shuyukh, there was a few points about what we need to do or how we should be as Muslims, right, with regards to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the two of the points, one of them was we have to love the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's family, and we have to love the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's companions. No. How important is that?
That's extremely important. It's part of our iman. Part of our faith, right, it is that we love the Messenger Ali, his family, his companions, and that we respect them and we honor them, and that we praise them, and that we make dua for them. Allah, because this is us believing in the Quran, because Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, He praises them in the Quran, the family and the companions of the Messenger Ali. Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he also mentions that Allah Azza wa Jalla is pleased with them. And if Allah Azza wa Jalla is pleased with them, that means that Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala is going to grant them Jannah, right? We believe that, and that is our faith. That is us believing in the Quran. That is us believing in the Sunnah of the Messenger alayhi salatu wa salam. So, and Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala says about us, وَالَّذِينَ جَاءُوا مِن بَعْدِهِمْ يقولون ربنا اغفر لنا ولإخواننا الذين سبقونا بالإيمان ولا تجعل في قلوبنا غلا للذين آمنوا. They say, Allah says, والذين جاءوا من بعدهم, those who come after the Sahaba, the generation that come after the Sahaba رضي الله عنهم. They say, يقولون, they say, ربنا, our Lord, اغفر لنا, forgive us, ولإخواننا الذين سبقونا بالإيمان, and our brothers who preceded us in faith, يعني the صحابة, and the family and so on, the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. ولا تجعل في قلوبنا غلا للذين آمنوا, do not place in our hearts hatred towards those who believe, right? So that's our belief. We don't have hatred towards Sahaba radiallahu anhum. Rather, that will go against our belief in the Quran, what Allah Tabarak is instructing us to do. Right? Allah Azza wa Jalla, he says, وَالسَّابِقُونَ الْأَوَّلُونَ مِنَ الْمُهَاجِرِينَ وَالْأَنصَارِ وَالَّذِينَ تَبَعُوهُمْ بِإِحْسَانٍ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُمْ وَرَضُوا عَنْهُ. That's the Sabiqun, those who were the forerunners who came to Islam first. الْأَوَّلُونَ مِنَ الْمُهَاجِرِينَ of the Muhajirin and Ansar. And those who followed them, who in goodness, Allah is pleased with them and they are pleased with Allah. Right? Allah Azza wa Jalla is testifying to this. So we have to believe in this. It's extremely important and that we venerate them. Like Shaykh Sami Timi, he says, حُبُّ الصَّحَابَةِ كُلُّهُمْ لِي مَذْهَبٌ وَمَوَدَّةُ الْقُرْبَى بِهَا أَتَوَسَّلُوا. When Shaykh Sami Timi, he mentions our creed and our belief, he says, حُبُّ الصَّحَابَةِ, loving the Sahaba, it is my belief, it is my creed. That's the believer, the Muslim, that's his belief. And it's وَمَوَدَّةُ الْقُرْبَى, and the affection that I have for the household of the Prophet, his family, I draw closer to Allah Azza wa Jalla. I try to get closer to Allah Azza with that. So no doubt it's an act of worship loving them, right? And these are the people who they conveyed Islam to us. So one individual, he tries to degrade them or he tries to cancel them, really what they are trying to do, they're trying to cancel Islam. Because what do? You can't go to, you know, you can't attack Islam straight away, right? So what would someone do? They would attack those who narrated it. They would try to discredit them. So once they're discredited, then the message would be discredited. That's what their aim is. So, and Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, he has given tazkiyah. He's told them, tick, they are 100% all trustworthy. All of them are trustworthy. What they attribute to the Messenger Ali is all of them are udud. That's what we believe, right? And we love them, etc. And we venerate them, we honor them, and we teach others about them as well, and they honor. Now,
one of the other things I read was that, like, one of the ways we can see that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam kind of cared and was concerned for us was the fact that he would want to make the rulings easy for us, and one of the ways we know that is about the hadith about the siwak during wudu. Mm-hmm. Are there other what other ways do we know that, like, about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam just wanting us to have almost like an easy path?
Naam. Islam, Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, has not made it difficult. Rather, Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala has made Islam easy for us. And Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, he sent the Messenger alayhi sallam to make things easy. And he sallallahu alayhi wasallam would say, yassiru wa la tuhassiru. Make things easy, don't make things difficult or complicated, right? And the Prophet alayhi sallam, he would be extremely difficult with himself. He'd make things hard for himself. He would be strict to himself, I should say. That's better wording. But with the Sahaba, he would make things easy for them. He would be lenient. And then he would also show that as well in his actions. He would also always be strict with him, because sometimes your actions speak louder than your words. Mm-hmm. He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if he was given two options, two matches, he would choose the easier one. To show that the objective of the Sharia is not to make things difficult, right? And even with ibadah, right? When Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala grants us a concession that we are allowed to make things, yani, to have it in to worship Allah in an easier way, the Prophet alayhi wa sallam would stick to it and he would make that his habit. Whenever he would travel, the Prophet alayhi wa sallam never ever completed the four raka'ah salah in traveling. He always kept it two, never ever made it four. To teach us that when Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala grants you a concession, he makes something easy for you, take it and stick to it. That is the sunnah. To take the easier path, right? So making things easy, it is an objective right? And also, it doesn't mean that when we say we're making things easy, that we water things down so much that there's almost no Islam left. La, it means that things that Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala has made vast, that He hasn't made it so difficult, and He made it quite vast, and there's quite a few options that you have. Okay, you can pick the easier option, right? But there's one is matters that only have one way, one method, except no classes, that's the way it must be done, right? And the Prophet alayhi salam, for instance, people will come to him in Hajj, and Hajj, you can imagine, is a difficult act of worship, and is busy, etc. And so some of the Sahaba, they would come because, you know, there's certain things that you have to do in certain order. The Prophet told them to do, so he taught them to do in certain order. But the Sahaba, because of how busy he was, etc., and the traffic and so on, they said, Ya Rasul, can I do this before this, or if I've done this? The Prophet asked them, If'al wala haraj. You say, do it and wala haraj. Okay, and there's no blame upon you, right? To show that this mas'ala specifically, Allah has made it easy. It's not too complicated to look at the situation of the people. The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, in the hadith that you mentioned, لَوْلَا أَنَ شُقَّ عَلَىٰ أُمَّتِي لَأَمَرْتُمْ بِسِوَاكَ عَنْدَ كُلِّ صَلَىٰ أَوْ عَنْدَ كُلِّ وُضُوْ. He said that if I wasn't, or بعد كل وضوء, he said, if I didn't want to make things difficult for my ummah, I would have commanded them to use a siwak before every salah and after every wudu. Also, the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, one day, he said to Sahaba, أيها الناس إن الله فرض عليكم الحج فحجوا. الله تبارك وتعالى has made حج obligatory upon you, so perform حج. And then one of the Sahaba, he got up, he said, Ya Rasulallah, he asked the question, أفي كل عام يا Rasulallah, do we have to do حج every single year? The Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام went quiet, because he's asking about something he wasn't told about, right? And the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, he said, if I said yes, it would become obligatory, but don't ask about matters. If you find out the answer, it'll make things difficult for you. Look at that, and the rahmah, right? Because nobody, not everyone can perform hajj every year, right? Go from the Muslims, especially now, it's not possible. So out of rahmah, taysir, to make things easy, and that's with all matters of life. So we shouldn't look at Islam, that Islam is difficult, right? Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala, He says to us in the Quran, فَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ مَا اسْتَطَعْتُمْ. Fear Allah as much as you can. What does that mean? That what Allah has obliged upon you, do it to the best of your ability. Whatever you can't do, whatever you're not able to do, Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala will not hold you accountable for, right? Allah says, well, the Messenger alayhi salatu salam, he says, مَا نَهَيْتُكُمْ عَنْهُ فَاجْتَنِبُهُ وَمَا أَمَرْتُكُمْ بِهِ فَأْتُوا بِهِ مِنْهُ مَا اسْتَطَعْتُمْ. He says that whatever I prohibited you from, then stay away from it. And whatever I, when prohibitions come, he says stay away from it. He didn't say as much as you can. But when he said whatever I commanded you with, do it to the best of your ability. As for haram, we have to stay away from. There's no, I can't, etc. La, there's no excuse. Right? There's no ease there. But when it comes to what we've been commanded, do it to the best of your ability. Meaning that, look, I'll give you an example with salah, right? The Prophet alayhi salam, when he thought about salah, okay, stand. If you can't stand, sit. If you can't sit, lie down. If you can't lie down, right? Okay, move your head. Okay, if you can't move your head, pray with your eyes. If you can't pray with your eyes, pray with your intention. And your situation to the best of your ability, right? Ease. Perform the obligation, but to the best of your ability. Right, Islam has, no one is excused. Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala has not left anything out. Islam caters for everyone, right? And the Prophet alayhi salam as well, he's an example. He's the only person that every single human being, male and female alike, can relate to. And that's why Allah taught us to imitate him and take him as a role model. Because the Prophet alayhi salam, he went through everything that perhaps we have gone through or we're going to go through. He went through it. You name it, he's gone through it. You name everything, I'll give you an example. Right? Mm. So that's why it's upon us to learn about him, because it teaches us how he dealt with these issues, right? How he was and how he reacted and so on. And then we can take lessons so that we can react in a positive manner like the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam.
Sallallahu alayhi wasalam. In wanting to get into know the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam more, I want to ask about two things. What we know about his physical appearance and what his homes were like. I think a lot of us are like visual, so just understanding like the size of his home and how things were. We know that, for example, he would leave his house and go to the masjid. How close was it to the masjid? Nah. Sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And then after that, I also want to know a bit about towards the end of his life. Sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So we'll start with a kind of like a description.
Allahumma salli wa sallim ala Nabi Muhammad. Talking about the description of the Prophet alayhi wasallam, it makes me very excited. I get very excited talking about it because Al-Imam Tirmidhi, rahimahullah, he has a book called Shama'il Muhammadiyya, which talks about the physical appearance and the character of the Prophet alayhi wa sallam. He describes the Prophet, all the narrations that talk about the character of the Prophet alayhi wa sallam, he mentions it, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Imam Tirmidhi, in his book Shama'il Muhammadiyya, he describes the physical appearance of the Prophet alayhi wa sallam. The Prophet alayhi wa sallam, let's try to summarize it, because going about all of it, it might be difficult slightly. The Prophet عليه السلام, he wasn't very tall and he wasn't very short. He was average height, right? And you wouldn't look at him and see, or you think, oh, he's very tall. And you wouldn't think he's very short. And he had the perfect height, right? And he wasn't fat and he wasn't very thin, but he was built. He was slightly built and he looked, يعني, mashallah, very muscular. يعني. And he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he had his chest and his stomach were the same, little same level. And his stomach wasn't sticking out, right? It was same level, right? And he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if we talk about his face, his skin tone, okay, he wasn't very, very pale and he wasn't very dark, but he was going towards a kind of tanned kind of skin tone. And he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his hair, okay, it was very soft and it wasn't very hard, but it was curly, his hair, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he had a very long, thick beard, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And sometimes he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, would leave his hair long and it reach up to his shoulders. And sometimes he would cut it, shorten it, etc., depending, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, okay, Anas radiallahu anhu, or the Sahaba, they would say that we would look at the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, and we would look at it would be a night that it would be a full moon. And then we look at the full moon, and then we look at the Prophet alayhi salam, and then we look at the full moon, and then we look at the Prophet alayhi salam, and then we look at the full moon. And then they say, wallahi, the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam would be even more beautiful than the full moon. And his face was enlightening, was brighter and more radiant than the full moon. Allahu Akbar. And if the moon was there, it would be enough. It would enlighten up the whole area. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he had thick eyebrows and his eyebrows were not connected. They were close together, but they weren't connected. He didn't have a monobrow. He, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his teeth, right, they were straight and they had tiny gaps in between them. And it looked so beautiful that when you smile, the Sahaba, they would be so radiant to his smile that they would just stare at him in awe, right? Because how beautiful his smile was. It would have, yani, it wouldn't be, the teeth wouldn't be so close together that, you know, it doesn't look nice when teeth are too close together and they're overlapping, etc. And they wouldn't be too spaced apart that it has big gaps. Like, it had tiny little gaps in between them. It looked so beautiful. It looked like the Sahaba, they were saying, when you open his mouth, like, noodles coming out. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his fragrance, his natural fragrance was like musk. You know, when he would sweat musk, right? To the extent that the people, they would store his sweat and they use it for perfume, and they would use it for months, a long period of time, because it would be very long lasting, subhanAllah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Right? Look, this is just one aspect. If we go to go on, right? What haven't I mentioned? Right? He, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the way he would walk, right? And he would hold himself, his character, etc. He would walk as if he's going up a mountain, as if he's going up a mountain or going down a mountain, right? It would be quite fast, right? And like someone who's on a mission, that's how he'd walk, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, with a quite fast pace, sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. And he gave every single person, yani, he was always bashush, he would always smile at the people, he would always show them happiness. Even if he's feeling sadness inside, he would never ever show that it's apparent. He was extremely humble, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That's a man, he walked in, he saw the Prophet alayhi wa sallam, he was startled. And then he said, don't be startled, I'm the son of a woman who used to eat the dry meat in Mecca. And look at this, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he's the best of creation. But despite that, he's extremely humble, he's the best looking, okay, individual, okay, still humble. Like, he had all the traits that, huh, ever could wish for, right? Beauty, right? The Prophet Ali, sorry,
he had haiba, right?
Yeah, he had haiba, right? He had the haiba, respect, not all the people they had for him, right? But on top of that, the Prophet Ali, most people, they think that this is something I want us to imagine now. And I know a lot of people, I'm sure all those who are listening, we all have perhaps our favorite reciter that recites Quran, and we love to listen to him, etc. Okay, the Prophet alayhi salam, he had the best recitation, and Umm Salam, she describes the recitation of the Prophet alayhi salam. But the Prophet had a beautiful voice, and he had an extremely beautiful voice, and his recitation was beautiful. Now imagine, yani, the Prophet alayhi salatu salam hearing his recitation of the Quran, and yani, imagine how much we'd enjoy it and so on. And the Prophet alayhi salatu salam, he says in hadith, ma adina Allahu li shay'in, Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala doesn't listen attentively, like Allah Azza wa Jalla, he loves to listen to and listen to attentively a prophet who's been given a beautiful voice reciting the Quran, right? So Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala loves to listen to that, right? So the Prophet alayhi salam, every aspect, it's nurun ala nur. Nurun ala nur. No, that's the physical appearance. And to some extent, we mentioned a few things.
Jazakallah khair. And you mentioned Shama'il al-Muhammadiyya.
Naam, Shama'il al-Muhammadiyya. Okay, this book, Imam al-Tirmidhi, rahimahullah azza wa jalla, he mentioned all the traits of the Prophet alayhi salam and so on, and his characteristics, his personality, and his physical appearance, all that. And the last hadith he mentions, he ends the book with, okay, it's the hadith which says that Allah, the Messenger alayhi salam, he says, Man ra'ani, okay, whoever sees me, okay, in a dream, he has seen me. فَإِنَّ الشَّيْطَانَ لَا يَتَمَثَلْ بِي, because shaitan doesn't come in my form. Why does he end his book with this? He ends it with this because after reading this book, يعني, so that you can have a dream about the Prophet, it should increase your love for the Prophet عليه السلام, so that you love the Prophet عليه السلام more, and that you dream about the Prophet عليه السلام. And if you see the Prophet عليه السلام in a dream, you have seen him really, because the shaitan doesn't come in the form of the Prophet عليه السلام. But now you know the description to look out for after reading his book, so that when you read the book, you have the description, and then if you see someone looks like that, خلاص, you see the Prophet عليه السلام. There was a young man, okay, he wanted to see the Prophet عليه السلام in a dream. And then what happened? He went to Sheikh and said to Sheikh, I've been trying to see the Prophet ﷺ in a dream, but it's not happening. What do I do? So Sheikh, he said, told him, okay, I'm going to help you, inshallah. He told him to come to his house for dinner. So the young man, he came to the Sheikh's house, he had dinner with him, and the Sheikh, he told him, you're going to stay with me tonight, inshallah, you're going to sleep in my house. So after the Sheikh, he gave him food, he gave him a lot of food, a lot of salty food. And then he didn't give a lot of salty food, yeah. Okay. And then he didn't give any water. Imagine having a lot of salty food, your throat must be dry after that, right? He didn't give any water. So he told him, go to sleep. So the young man, he went to sleep. And then what happened? He had a dream. What was the dream? All he dreamt about was water. Because that's all he desired. Yeah. He woke up, he said, yeah, Sheikh. It didn't work. I didn't see the Prophet alayhi salatu salam. All I saw was water and oceans and rivers and all this stuff. And he said, you know why you saw the water? It's because at that moment, the thing you desired most was water. If you really love the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, you really desire to see him, you will see him in a dream. That was a lesson for him. So if you really desire to see the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام in a dream, we are the ones who imitate him, and we follow his example, and we learn about him, and we teach others about him. And we, if we really desire to see him, inshallah ta'ala, Allah Azza will honor us, hopefully, to see him in a dream. Sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam.
Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Sheikh, so let's move on to the end of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's life, and because we're 1 hour, just to give you update with time, because we don't have any clocks in the room, we're an hour and 20 minutes in, so Maghrib is about 40 minutes ish away. So maybe if we go for another maybe 20 minutes till 4:30, that will give us some time before Maghrib, inshallah. The end of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's life, what
Allahumma
do we know?
Salli wa sallim ala nabiyyina Muhammad. Allahumma salli wa sallim ala nabiyyina Muhammad. The Prophet alayhi salatu salam, he died yesterday. What was the date yesterday? The 12th of Rabi' al-Awwal, right? That's the day that he passed away, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Right? We're certain that's the day he passed away. He, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, towards the end of his life, he became ill. And this illness, it made him extremely sick. And he made him bedbound, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, people are visiting him in his home, etc. And, you know, they're hoping the Prophet is going to get better, etc. And so on, he had a fever, and so on, ila akhiri. So, when this illness came about, one day the Prophet, alayhi wa sallam, felt a little bit better. He told the Sahaba, radiallahu anhu, take him to the masjid. And the masjid of the Prophet, alayhi wa sallam, was right next to his house, right? The houses of the Prophet ﷺ is Hijr, okay, his Hujurat, they were around the masjid. So you literally come out and they'll be the masjid, right? So he told the Sahaba to lift him and take him to the masjid, and he ascended the pulpit, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He's sick, extremely sick, very frail, very delicate, and very weak. And then he delivered a sermon, and he said, Ayyuhan nas, man kanat lahu madlamah, whoever I have oppressed, and he's holding me account for something, please take that back now. Take that back now before a day comes, لَا يَنْفَعُ مَالٌ وَلَا بَنُونَ, a day comes that no wealth and no offspring will benefit. And he kept repeating this. All the Sahaba are just, they're just saying, Ya Rasul, what can we say? Well, you never oppress anyone, right? And then he said, what do you think about a slave that Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala khayyarahu Allah, Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala has given him a choice between the dunya and the akhirah, and then he chose the akhirah, right? And then as he said this, Abu Bakr started weeping, crying. He started crying. Because when the Prophet ﷺ said this, he was referring to himself. No one realized. They thought it was a general reminder about the hereafter. Abu Bakr, Umar said, وَكَانَ أَفْقَهُنَا أَبُو بَكْرٍ. Abu Bakr was the most knowledgeable amongst us. He realized, he understood who the Prophet ﷺ was referring to, he was himself. And he started weeping, Abu Bakr, and the rest of them are listening. And the Prophet ﷺ saying, whoever has a madlama, whoever I have oppressed, please take this back from me now before a day comes where there will be no wealth and no offspring that will benefit us. And then it is said that a man who donated Ukasha, he came up. And this narration, it said that is weak. But some of the ulama of Maghazi, they say that narrations that have, that are due to with seerah, even if they have a slight weakness in their chain, it can be narrated, right? And they yatasahalun fiha. Right, so they don't take it as they're not as strict with it as they are with ahadith regarding ahkam, etc. Da'if wouldn't be accepted, but with here they say because the da'af is yasir, the weakness is quite small. So it's said that a man who's known as Ukash, he came and he said, Ya Rasulullah, one day when you were straight in rows for a battle, you whacked me with a stick in my stomach. You told me to go back and you hit me in my stomach. He said, Ya Rasulullah, I want to get back my right. Imagine. So the Prophet ﷺ told one of the Sahaba, go get a stick. And he bought the stick. And then he gave the stick to Ukasha. And he told Ukasha, hit me. Look at this, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And look at the lesson he's teaching us. And then Ukasha said, Ya Rasulullah, my stomach was uncovered when you hit me. Uncover your stomach. Look at this. So the Prophet ﷺ, with weakness, he uncovered his stomach. And then Ukash radiallahu anhu arda, he came and he kissed the stomach of the Messenger alayhi salatu salam. He said, Ya Rasulullah, I wanted the last thing that touches my skin to be your skin. Look at that, the Sahaba, the love they had for the Prophet alayhi salatu salam. Then after the Messenger alayhi salatu salam, after that incident, he went back home and his situation wasn't getting better. He wasn't getting any better. So the Monday came, the 12th of Rabi' al-Awwal. And this Monday, the Prophet ﷺ told Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu to lead the people in Salah. Abu Bakr was leading people in Salah. Fajr time came, Abu Bakr leading the people in Salah. And then the Prophet ﷺ felt a little bit better. So what did he do? As they're praying Salah, he uncovered, there was like a curtain in between him and the masjid. So he uncovered it, and he could see the Sahaba praying. And then they saw him and someone got distracted. They got, because the Prophet is looking better. They said, Alhamdulillah, he's getting better. And they had high hopes. He's going to get better, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He's going to feel better. He's going to come back and everything's going to be back to normal. That's the hopes that they had. So he looked and someone got distracted. And the Prophet ﷺ told them to carry on in prayer. And he indicated to them and he closed the curtain. And then after that day, then he stayed, started to deteriorate. And it got worse. He got more ill. And then he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was in the house of Aisha. He was going around the houses of all his wives, giving them all their right. and they knew that he wanted to be in Aisha's house. So one of the wives of the Prophet, alayhi wa sallam, she compromised her time with the Prophet, alayhi wa sallam, and gave it to Aisha. Look at that. Because they knew how much he loved Aisha and so on. So he was in the house of Aisha, and Aisha's taking care of him. Right? She's nursing him. And people are coming in to see the Prophet, alayhi salatu wasalam. Right? It's his last moments. And they're coming to see the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, coming to visit him one by one, etc. Visiting him, etc. and so on. And then Abdullah ibn Abi Bakr, Abdurrahman ibn Abi Bakr radiallahu anhu, he came in and he had a miswak. He was using a miswak. The Prophet alayhi looked at the miswak. He couldn't speak properly, the Prophet alayhi, because of how sick he was. And then Aisha noticed that he wanted the miswak. She got the miswak from her brother and she chewed it up for the Prophet alayhi salam, and he started using the miswak. Even towards the end of his life, he's using the miswak. Look at that. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because he wanted to meet Allah Azza wa Jalla in the best state, purest state. So he's using the miswak to purify himself, to purify his mouth. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his daughter, she came to him, Fatima. And then he whispered something in her ear. And then when he whispered the first thing in her ear, she laughed. She became happy, she rejoiced. And he whispered something else and then she cried. When the first thing he whispered in her ear, it was that he's going to pass away, and she cried. And then the second thing he told her, it was that she was going to be the first one from his family to join him, to follow him. And then she rejoiced. She became happy, radiallahu anha. And then the Prophet alayhi salam, he's in the lap of Aisha. His head is the lap of Aisha radiallahu anha. And he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he's now been given choice. Right? He was saying, بَلْ الرَّفِيقُ الْأَعْلَى بَلِ الرَّفِيقُ الْأَعْلَى بَلِ الرَّفِيقُ الْأَعْلَى بَلِ الرَّفِيقُ الْأَعْلَى Rather, I choose the highest companion. I choose the highest companion. And Aisha radiallahu anha, when she heard him mumbling this under his breath, she said, فَعَلِمْتُ أَنَّهُ يُخَيِّرُ I realized that he was being given a choice between the dunya and the akhirah. And I realized that he was choosing the akhirah, and she became sad. And she's going to lose her husband, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he started giving his last advices. He started advising the people about salah, about the rights of the people, about... And then the last thing the Prophet, alayhi wa sallam, said, before he left this world, the last statement is ala itlaq, he said, Allahumma ghafir li warhamni wa alhiqni bil rafiq al-ala. He said, oh Allah, forgive me and have mercy upon me and let me be amongst the highest companion. And then he left this world, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And that was the saddest day for this ummah, that the Rasul, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the best messenger that was sent to them, he left this world with calamity. That's why the Prophet, alayhi wa sallam, said, whoever is afflicted with calamity, think of the calamity of losing me, that will make your calamity less. And then he left. And then people had found out about the death of the Prophet. Some people were shocked. They didn't know how to react. They couldn't believe it. Umar radiallahu anhu, he found out and he became angry. He said, the Prophet hasn't died. Whoever says the Prophet has died, he said, I'm going to cut his neck. He said he's gone to his Lord, just like Musa alayhi salam went to Allah, and then he's going to come back. He said these munafiqeen are saying that he's dead. They're lying. He was denying it. He didn't want to believe it. And then Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu was away. He heard about the news. He came to the Prophet alayhi salam. Look at this man, Rajul Hakim, this wise man, Abu Bakr, this leader who's going to lead the ummah of the Messenger alayhi salatu salam. He came to the Prophet alayhi salatu salam. He looked at him. And then he looked at the Messenger alayhi salam, his best friend, his companion, his Khalil, his beloved one, his most beloved one. And he looked at him and he kissed the Prophet alayhi salatu salam on his forehead. And he said, طِبْتَ حَيًّا وَمَيِّتًا يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ He said, you are pure, O Messenger of Allah, حَيًّا وَمَيِّتًا You are pure, dead and alive, O Messenger of Allah. Dead and alive, you are pure, O Messenger of Allah. And then he kissed the Messenger alayhi salatu salam. And then he went out, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, when he addressed the people. He saw Umar radiallahu anhu was shouting and he said, Ala risliki ya Umar, calm down, Umar. And Umar wouldn't listen, so Abu Bakr ignored him and he delivered his sermon. And then he said, Ayyuhan nas, man kana ya'budu Muhammadan fa inna Muhammadan qad mat. Wa man kana ya'budu Allah fa inna Allah hayyun la yamut. He said, radiallahu anhu, whoever used to worship Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Muhammad has passed away. And whoever used to worship Allah and worships Allah, then Allah is hay, ever living, everlasting, will never die. And then he recited the ayah, وَمَا مُحَمَّدٌ إِلَّا رَسُولٌ قَدْ خَلَتْ مِنْ قَبْلِهِ الرُّسُلُ أَفَإِمَّاتَ أَوْ قُتِلَ انْقَلَبْتُمْ عَلَىٰ عَقَابِكُمْ وَمَنْ يَنْقَلِبُ عَلَىٰ عَقِبَيْهِ فَلَنْ يَضُرَّ اللَّهَ شَيْئًا وَسَيَجْزِي اللَّهُ الشَّاكِرِينَ That Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is not except a messenger. Before him have come messengers and prophets. أَفَإِمَّاتَ If he was to die, أَوْ قُتِلَ To be killed, انْقَلَبْتُمْ عَلَىٰ عَقَابِكُمْ Are you going to turn back on your heels? يعني leave Islam. وَمَنْ يَنْقَلِبُ عَلَىٰ عَقِبَيْهِ Whoever turns back on his heels, فَلَنْ يَضُرَّ اللَّهَ شَيْئًا He's not going to harm Allah Azza at all, not in any way. وَسَيَجْزِي اللَّهُ شَاكِرِينَ And Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala is going to reward those who are grateful. The Prophet alayhi salam, towards the end of his life, his sakarat al-maut, the pain and the agony of his death, it was multiplied more than any person endured. And he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as he was dying, he said, Ah, inna lil-mawti la-sakarat, inna lil-mawti la-sakarat, inna lil-mawti la-sakarat. He said, verily death, it has pain and agony that comes with him. Pain and agony that comes with it. He went through extra pain that none of us have gone through. He was tested a lot more than we were ever tested. And this is all because he was the most beloved to Allah Azza wa Jal. And those who Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala loves the most, he tested the most. And the Messenger alayhi wa sallam, he left this world. He never ever see any pain. He never ever see any hardship. And that's what Abu Bakr said when he saw him, Ya Rasulallah, you have left the painful dunya. You're not going to see any trials. You're not going to see any hardship. You're not going to see any afflictions. No difficulty anymore, Ya Rasulallah. You have gone to Dar al-Akhirah, the home of the Akhirah. In it is goodness for eternity for Ya Rasulullah. This is how the Messenger alayhi salatu salam, he left this world. He kept advising us about our salahs and maintaining and observing our rights and the rights of others, etc. And this is the advices that he left us with, sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, rahmatil alameen. Even the last moments, normally someone would be thinking about themselves, but he was thinking about his ummah, thinking about us, advising us in the last moment that he was leaving this world, subhanallah. Right? It should be a lesson to all of us that we don't let the Messenger alayhi salam down, the one who cried for us, the one who stood nights until his feet would swell, and he would cry to Allah Tabarak wa Ta'ala about his ummah, and he make dua for us, and he would cry and weep to the extent you would think that every single one of us is going to the hellfire. That's how afraid the Messenger alayhi salam was. We don't want to be amongst those who come Yawm al-Qiyamah that disappoint the Messenger alayhi sallam, let him down. Let's not disappoint the Messenger alayhi sallam, let him down, so that we can attain his intercession Yawm al-Qiyamah, and we attain his companionship in Jannah Firdaws A'la, and that is through following his sunnah and learning about him and teaching others about him and following his example sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Qul in kuntum tuhibbuna Allah fattabi'uni yuhibbukum Allah wa yaghfir lakum dhunubakum wallahu ghafurur rahim. Sayyidina Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam, if you truly love Allah, then follow me, follow Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam. Yuhibbukum Allah, Allah will love you and forgive your sins, and Allah the most forgiving and the most merciful. And as a poet, is Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah azza wa jal, he said that he said, لو كان حبك صادقا لأطعته إن المحب لي من يحب مطيع. If your love for the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, if you're truthful in that love, that you love the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, لأطعته, you'll obey him, for verily the one who loves someone who obeys him, right? Obey Allah and obey the Messenger عليه الصلاة والسلام. اللهم صل على محمد. نعم.
JazakAllah khair for joining us today, Ustaz. Thank you so much for, you know, last minute accepting my invitation. And is there any, I will end it there because of the time, if that's okay with you. JazakAllah khair for everyone who watched live. Thank you to those who are watching after. This live stream is going to remain on the channel, inshallah. And I saw someone in the comments ask that earlier. Will we be able to watch this after? Yes, it will be on the channel. It will remain on the channel once YouTube has processed it, inshallah. And I'm going to do my best to make sure that it also gets onto the podcast app. But just bear with me with that, because it might not be straight away. But for now, it will remain on YouTube, inshallah. Jazakallahu khairan to everybody for watching. And this was like an extra episode. There was an episode out already today. So if you guys want to see more Fresh Grind content, you can check out the episode from earlier today. Jazakallahu khairan once again. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.